Good evening. We welcome you live to the Sanctuary of Encounter Church on this beautiful Wednesday evening. The evening, the night that the Lord has made to encounter you, to encounter us, to encounter us together as one team. So, Father, we come before you this evening asking you to have your way. Lord, we set the table for to have you join us this evening. We ask that your kingdom come. We ask that your will be done here on earth as it is in heaven, here in this sanctuary as it is in heaven. As you saw fit for tonight, Father God, we thank you that we have the opportunity to gather together. So we come before you with one heart. We come before you with one mind. We come before you as one team. And we ask you, wind of the Lord, blow in the direction that you see fit for us tonight. We ask again, wind of the Lord, blow in us the way that you see fit for us tonight. So we thank you for that. We invite you to like, comment, and share, because we believe that as we become an evangelist, as we become the evangelist of the Lord, here, so simple, we do not even need to step outside in 2022 to become an evangelist. Let me repeat that. We do not even need to step outside in 2022 in order to be an evangelist. All you have to do is use your finger from your house tonight and share, like, and comment, because the evangelist within you, the great evangelist, is going to work through us. Let me repeat that. The great evangelist is going to work through us, and we have an opportunity to do that as one team, just like our vision, to encounter the presence of God and to equip people of all backgrounds to become disciples of Jesus Christ, laborers for his kingdom, one united loving family, having one heart with one purpose, together as one team, touching our community and reaching the world. That's exactly what we have the honor and privilege to do tonight as we engage together as one. If you have a youth or a young adult, I invite you to have them join us tonight at 7:20 via Zoom as we start to, we're not going to kickstart our new series yet, but we're going to scratch the surface of our new series, which we're going to embark on next week. Let me repeat that. We're going to scratch the surface on our new series titled Hydrate. Hydrate. Walking in the showers, walking in the living water. We're going to be talking about how in the natural we have spring water, purified water, distilled water, and even sparkling water. And we're going to show how God is going to use us for such a time as this to come and drink together. So tonight we have an opportunity to gather together and drink. So let's do that tonight as one team.
Gather together and drink as one team. Amen. All day, every day, right? All day, every day. We can drink. Drink of the Spirit. Well, good evening. Love you guys so much. If you don't know who I am, I know who you are, or at least most of you. I will find out in a few minutes when I'm able to see who you are. But most of you are from Encounter Church, but not all of you, because there are those engaging from coast to coast by the power of the Holy Ghost. And like Pastor Eddie was saying, you know, just from your fingertips, you can get engaged in the ministry now at any time, really. So there are people watching from coast to coast by the power of the Holy Ghost. Some of you, most of you we know, some of you we don't know. So I'm Pastor Jim DePalma. Welcome live to the Sanctuary of Encounter Church. We love you with the love of the Lord. And thank God that tonight, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit has his way. Now, in just a couple of moments, Joseph Perry, elder in the church, he's going to come and lead us in prayer. Now, when we're engaged in the building, sometimes people, you can hear them pray. Well, most times you can. You can see their actions and reactions. We say, let's stretch our hands, we stretch our hands. We say, let's lift our voice, we lift our voice. But at home, we trust the Holy Spirit in you. Now, we don't trust anybody's flesh, including mine. But we trust the Holy Spirit in you that as Joe prays, we will engage with him because he's praying for your son. He's praying for your need. He's praying for your daughter. He's praying for your mate or your future mate or whatever it is. So we're coming into agreement together. So we want to make sure, maybe this is for you, maybe this is for somebody else, okay? But I'm saying it for all of us. We want to make sure that we don't have one eye on our hamburger and another eye on Joe. No, we want to give our undivided attention, listen to this, we want to give our undivided attention and our undivided affection. Because the affectionate prayer or effectual prayer, both, of the righteous avails much. Not any prayers. You know, there are people praying in hell right now. They're trying to scream their way out of there. They're trying to scream their way out. And they're in there forever. So when Joe prays tonight, we want to pray with fire. We want to pray with urgency, not with an eye on my drink and an eye on what does he think. No. Let's submerge. There's a word. Somebody comment those two words. Let's submerge. Because as we submerge, you're going to see breakthrough because one puts 1,000 to flight. Two puts 10,000 to flight when those one and two are submerged. If any two shall agree about anything they ask, anything, when they submerge together in agreement. So as Joe leads us in prayer tonight, we're going to submerge together. I'm not just going to listen to him pray. I'm not just going to hear him pray. I'm going to agree with him in my whole heart, with all of my heart, with all my soul. That's where I get my breakthrough. It's not by watching, it's engaging. So because you say, why are you talking this way? Because God's about to bless your socks off. I said, God's about to bless your socks off. But never has anyone received a miracle just by watching. But they receive it by participating and engaging. And that's what we're doing tonight. And those of you that are new to us tonight, we welcome you, but that's what we're doing. We don't just watch, we're not entertained, but we engage to the glory of the Lord. So as Joe comes up, we're going to pray. Boy, we have another hot issue on our hands with abortion. And really, we got to get to the root, church. We got to get to the root because the enemy is at war again, even bringing strife in the body of Christ. Even bringing strife in the body of Christ. And yes, we believe in the sanctity of life. We sure do. Yes, we believe in pro-life. But let me tell you something. We believe in whole life. Come on, somebody. Somebody comment. We believe in whole life. And I pray that God give you the revelation on what I just said. You see, I can't give you all the revelation. Some of it is caught, not taught. We believe in the revelation of whole life. You see what I'm saying? Whole life to the glory of God. Mm-hmm. We believe in that baby, and we believe in the value of that baby, but we believe in that baby's value when they're 5 and 10 and 20 and 30 if they make it that far. You see what I'm saying? We are pro-life, whole life to the glory of God. So as Joe prays, let's engage together. Our hearts as one. And we're going to believe God for a mighty breakthrough tonight as we participate and engage together right now in Jesus' name. Are you ready at home? Are you ready? Are you ready? You ready? Okay, Joe, they're going to engage with us together to the glory of the Lord.
Yes, they are.
Good to see you, buddy.
Good to see you too, Apostle.
And while you're praying, you can take a breath, okay?
All right.
You know, he's 64 now. I'm 65, and thank you for blessing me for Father's Day. Amen. Thank you for blessing me for my birthday. Thank you so much. You guys are so awesome. You're so honorable, so loyal.
Amen.
And yeah, you say, how's it feel being like, how's it feel being 65? Can I tell you how it feels? It feels like being 64.
That's right.
Because Joe's 64. You say, when you were 64, how did it feel? It felt like I was 63. Okay, you get it. But Joe, we love you, buddy.
We love you, too.
You're a young man. And I love, you know, when you shave, I always say you shave like you get that baby close shave. Aww. See? See what we're doing, guys? This is a setup for warfare.
That's right.
This is a setup for travail because we're the army of the Lord. If we can't do it, nobody can. I'll say it again. If we can't do it, I'd ask you to text that or comment that, but that's a long one. If we can't do it, nobody can. But we can.
Yeah, that's
because
right.
We're the army of the Lord.
Yes, we are.
We can do all things through Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Let's do it, guys.
Okay.
Let's do it. My house shall be called what, Joe?
The house of prayer.
Bingo. Love you. I'll see you in a little bit.
All right. Let's join together. Let's engage. Let's agree. And let's pray. Right now, I want you to comment. I want you to share. And I want you to pray. Let's pray right now for the fivefold ministry, because they need our prayer. They need our intercession and they need our covering. So right now, let's lift up every apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, and teacher. Father, we thank you, Father God, for your fivefold ministry. For Lord, it's not ours, but it's yours. So our job, Lord God, is to protect them and to cover them, Father. So we thank you, Father God, for the privilege of praying for them, for holding up their arms. Father God, as you strengthen them, as you send warring angels, Father God, as you continue to encourage them and strengthen them and raise them up in these last days. Father, we pray that they would have more encounters with you, fresh encounters, Lord God, revelations upon revelations. Continue, Lord God, to show them and reveal mysteries, Lord God, as they open your word, Father God. I thank you that the word of God will become life-giving, because they're going to take that and send it forth to the body of Christ. And Father, we thank you for it. Let it come in Jesus' name. Let it come. We pray for every fivefold minister, their spouses, their children, their grandchildren and great-grandchildren in Jesus' name. We pray for their family members, Father God. We pray, Lord God, for their churches, Lord God, for their members, Lord God, and those that you're bringing in to the body of Christ in Jesus' name. And now let's pray for our spiritual father and spirit at Encounter Church. Father God, we thank you, Father God, and we lift up Apostle and Pastor Joni, and we speak your blessings and favor upon them, Lord God. Let it in mighty way, Father God. Let your favor, Lord God, overtake them. Let it, Father God, just rest upon them in a great and mighty way. Father, continue, Lord God, to use them and strengthen them. We pray, Lord God, for strength and renewed strength, Lord God. We pray, Lord God, that you continue to lead them and guide them, Father God. Every step they take, Father God, we just call them blessed of the Lord, Father God. Every place that their feet touch, everything that their hands shall engage in, it will be to your glory, Father God. And we will see great fruit, Father God, and continue to use them, Lord God, to speak to the body of Christ, to speak to Encounter Church. And we call them blessed of the Lord in Jesus' mighty name. And now let's pray for the United States of America. Let's pray, Lord God. Let's pray for the body of Christ to believe and to start crying out for whole life from the womb, Father God, all the way to the tomb. Father, we pray right now for our nation, Lord God. Lord God, your peace, Lord God, not man's peace, but your peace that's beyond our understanding. Lord God, we pray, Lord God, dear God, for racial reconciliation in the mighty name of Jesus. Let us sit together. Let us come and reason together, Father God. You have birthed this country, Father God, with every tribe, every nation. So, Father God, we thank you, Lord God, that you are gathering us together to be one nation under God, to give you glory. In the mighty name of Jesus. And now let's pray for the nations of the world. Father, we pray, Lord God, for every nation, every continent, Lord God. We ask, Lord God, for you to come again. Visit us, Father God, in our nation, in the nations of the world. Sweep across, Lord God, every nation, every continent with revival fire. Father, we ask for the Holy Spirit to come with revival fire to change us, to change the church, to set us ablaze, that we are going forth as great evangelists to reach the lost at any cost, Father God. Burden our hearts, Lord God, as the body of Christ, with souls for your kingdom. And Father God, we pray for Ukraine. We pray for Israel and the peace of Jerusalem. Father God, we pray for those that are persecuted around the world. Father, we ask, Lord God, that you'd cover them and strengthen them and protect them against the wiles of the enemy. And we declare right now that no weapon that formed against the body of Christ shall prosper, that no weapon that forms against the leadership in the Jesus' mighty name. And now let's pray for our leaders, our governmental leaders right now. Father, we pray for the President of the United States. We pray for the Vice President. We pray for our senators and congressmen. Father God, we pray for our Supreme Court justices, for our governors, for our mayors, Lord God, for our state senators and representatives. Father, have your way, Father God. Lead them and guide them, we pray. Lord, we know the heart of the king is in your hands. Father God, lead them, we pray, in godliness and righteousness. Father, I pray that, Father, that you would just pour your spirit out upon them, that they would have godly encounters with you, Lord God. Lord God, as they're sitting there, Father God, reveal yourself to them in the mighty name of Jesus, that this nation again would declare one nation under God, that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. And we thank you for it, Father God, in Jesus' name. And now let's pray. Let's pray for those who protect us. Let's pray for those who put their lives. And I want you to comment right now. I want you to come into agreement with me. For those, Lord God, those police officers, firefighters, nurses, doctors, first responders, correctional officers, those on the border control agents, pray, pray. Let's send their names across that we would agree. Father God, we pray your protection over them, Father. Every police officer, Lord God, every firefighter, every, Father God, every correctional officer, border control agent, Father, every doctor, every nurse, everyone that's going out on assignment, Lord God, in an accident, a first responder, give them wisdom, I pray. Protect them, Lord God. We pray right now against premature death in the mighty name of Jesus, that they will not die early. They will fulfill the destiny of Almighty God, for they've been called, for Lord said you knew them before they were even formed in the womb. And Father God, we pray for fulfillment of their lives in Jesus' mighty name. And now let's pray for our schools. Let's start to prepare ourselves in prayer, even if only summer school is going on, because soon and very soon our kids are going to be back in school. So Father, we pray for our schools. We pray a hedge of protection over our schools even now. We ask, Lord God, that you would give the administrators, the principals, the teachers, great godly wisdom to protect our kids. Great godly wisdom to teach and to guide according to your ways, Lord God. We thank you, Father God, that our schools will be safe places, that our children will not be killed in Jesus' name. We come against that spirit of death and destruction. We come against the spirit of suicide and drug addiction in Jesus' name. Our children will live and not die. I want you to declare over this phone, over your cell phone, our children will live and not die to the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ. Right now, we thank you. We thank you, Father God. Let's pray right now for the church. I'm going to lift up the roster. I'm going to agree with those that are members, those that are hybrid members right now in Jesus' name. Let's pray. Father, we pray, Father God, for Encounter Church. We pray, Father God, for the hybrid church. We pray, Father God, for those that are online that connect with us, those that will connect with us in the future in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you, Father God, for you have blessed us. You've written your name on the doorposts of this church. And Father, we give you glory and honor in Jesus' mighty name. We pray blessings upon every member, every new member that's coming, every visitor, Father God, every saved soul that will be brought into the house of the Lord to be discipled and trained in Jesus' name. Blessed. We speak blessings of health. We speak blessings of deliverance. We speak blessings of prosperity. We speak blessings of salvation upon you and your family in Jesus' mighty name. And now let's pray for these prayer requests. Those that I'm holding, those that you've commented, those that have been emailed, right now come into agreement with me. I know you're believing God for a breakthrough. I know we're believing God for miracles. And we know that our God is a miracle working God. So right now let's pray. Father, we thank you for every prayer request. We thank you for every prayer request, for every email prayer request. In the name of Jesus, we agree, Father God, that it is answered. It has been answered, Lord, up in heaven and released from your throne room. And it's coming. It's coming. And it will manifest to your glory at the right perfect time in Jesus' mighty name. Now I want you to stand. I want you to comment. I believe you, Lord. I believe you, Lord. I believe it's coming. I believe you've answered it in Jesus' mighty name. And let's pray right now. Let's pray for our Sunday service. Father, we thank you, Father God. Father, we ask, Lord God, that you would come again. You come again, Father God. You are here every time we open these doors. Have your way on Sunday morning, Father God. We ask Holy Spirit to descend and to come upon us and to just do a great work. Change our hearts, I pray. Turn us to become more like Jesus in the name of Jesus. Speak to us through the word of God. Use apostle as your oracle to speak, thus saith the Lord. And I pray, Lord God, that everyone that is in this house that's connected will be fertile ground, that the word of God will go deep and bear fruit in Jesus' mighty name. And it's going to be for you, for the word of God is going to come into your life, and it's going to change you forevermore in Jesus' mighty name. And now let's pray for families. Let's pray. Father, we pray for fathers. We pray for mothers. We pray for marriages, children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, father, nieces, nephews, cousins, aunts, uncles. In Jesus' name, we just speak blessings upon them. We pray for those right now that are sick in body. Be healed in the mighty name of Jesus. I want you to comment and agree with me. Be healed in Jesus' mighty name. If you're standing in the gap for a loved one, I want you to comment it that we'll agree in Jesus' mighty name. Be healed on the authority and the power of the Holy Spirit in Jesus' mighty name. We pray for those, Father God, that need clarity of mind. Father God, for those that are sick in mind, in the mighty name of Jesus, we thank you, Lord God, that they have the mind of Christ. The clarity of mind is coming. We pray against Alzheimer's, dementia, PTSD disorders, in Jesus' mighty name. We pray against cancer, heart disease, afflictions. We pray against COVID, in Jesus' name, in every variant today. And we cast down any future variants. We arrest you now that you will not manifest in Jesus' mighty name. And right now, let's pray. Let's pray for those, Lord. Let's pray for those that are sick in Jesus' name. Father God, we pray, Father God, for divine healing. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, Father, heal. Heal your people. Heal the lost, I pray, that they would know that there's a merciful God and it would draw them to the saving grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. We pray, Lord God, for every missing child. Every time we see that newspaper, every time we see something on the television, every time we see a sign on the highway, we are going to believe, God, that that child is going to be found in Jesus' mighty name. We pray against sex trafficking. We pray against smugglers that are trying to smuggle people across the border in Jesus' mighty name. We pray, Lord God, for families, Father God, that have lost loved ones. Heal, Father God. Bring peace and comfort in Jesus' name. We pray, Father God, that you would reveal, Father God, every missing child, every missing adult. In the mighty name of Jesus, we thank you for it. In Jesus' name. And now I want to finish. We're going to finish by praying for the lost. And I want you to pray with passion and fire. I want you to believe God. I don't care what it looks like in the natural. We serve a God that's a supernatural God. He's not moved by anything on this earth. He's mighty. He's all powerful. And he can do what the saints of God cry out for. So I want you to pray for every lost friend, co-worker, family member, in Jesus' name, those in our neighborhoods. Father, we pray, Father God. We pray for the lost and dying. Save them, I pray, Father God. As we come into agreement, Father, we call upon you, Father God. We call upon every one of their names. Bobby, Joey, Jimmy, Cindy, Lisa, whoever it is, I want you to just agree in Jesus' name that they will be saved to the glory of God, that we will see them serving the Lord Jesus Christ, that we will see them with their hands raised before the altar of God, crying out, thank you, Jesus, for saving me. Right now, I want you to give the Lord the biggest shout of praise, knowing that your prayers have been answered, that you have received the breakthrough of Almighty God. Ready? Give the Lord a shout of praise. Hallelujah!
Wow.
Fire, Joe. Fire so strong I can hardly make my way up here. Thank you, Lamb of God. Whoa, fire. This man is anointed. This man is anointed all day, every day. This man is anointed. And tonight, Father, we thank you that your kingdom is coming and your will is being done in Jesus' name. Oh, Marina, I love you, sweetie. I miss you. I know you're downstairs on Sunday serving, right? She was downstairs serving.
Yes.
I love you, baby. Sunday, yes. Oh, you're so sweet. You're so beautiful. I love your beautiful children as well. Hi, Patrick. Hi, everybody. Let's see. Yeah, Marina, I love you, sweetie pie. Thank you all for blessing me so much. Mary Collada, let me tell you, God's going to do a work in your brother, Chris. I'm telling you, Christopher, God's going to do a work in his life to the glory of God. And CJ, I'm telling you, and CJ as well. Thank you, Lord God.
Amen.
Look at you. Hey, Marty, we're thanking the Lord for your precious healing.
Hallelujah.
It's good to see you this past Sunday, the last two Sundays. And Nidia serving again in the house of the Lord. Candy, what can I say? You're so sweet. Thank you for blessing us so much. Thank you all for blessing us so much. Let me see. Marina says she loves you. Hi, Sally. We love you too. Hi, Sally. We give the Lord a shout of praise. Nancy does. Yeah, Nancy. Nancy, we thank the Lord for your healing of your eyes. David Greer, we thank the Lord that I know you told me on Sunday that you're going into the hospital, I believe today. So we thank the Lord for a good report. We believe it's done now. We believe it's done now.
Yes.
In the mighty name of Jesus. Hello, Ida. Hello. She calls me Poppy. She calls me Poppy and Mama Joni. Yep. Medea, how you doing, baby? How's Mama doing?
Yes.
How's Mama doing?
Yes.
Yeah, Medea, how's Mama doing? How's family doing? Love you, Grandpa Jim and Grandma Pastor Joni. Oh, I tell you, I love my Charlie so much. We go out every day and we go. He looks for rocks.
He's a rock collector.
He's a rock collector. Yes, he is.
Awesome.
Yeah, he is a rock collector. Yeah, Marty, you're very welcome. We love you. Love you, Patrick. Marisol Garcia, Marisol Torres. Yes, thank the Lord. But my little Charlie is a rock collector. He is. So true story. Yesterday, I took him for a little walk. We took him for a little walk, and there was this rock. I kid you not, it was embedded in dirt, and I tried to take my 65-year-old fingers and get that rock out, but it was hard. My little Charlie, yeah, Odia, we love you too. Let's see, March, April, May, June. So our little Charlie is 15 months, actually he's gonna be 16 months, that little baby bull. Eileen, we love you, and Manny. My little grandson Charlie, at 12, what's he, gonna be 16 months, right?
Yes.
With one hand, he took his little baby fingers and he pulled that thing out of the ground. I couldn't believe it. I had to save it to give to Janelle and Mark. I had to save it. Hi, Judy. We're praying for Mama. We're praying for family.
Yes.
We're praying for your whole family, Judy, Ray, Gabriel, and of course, the princess. Oh, Princess Alexis, she blessed me so much for my birthday. She blessed me. She did. Now, Ray and Judy blessed me too, but Princess Alexis, she blessed me so much. Everybody did, but oh, that precious Alexis, I love her so much. I love her so much. Anyway, my little Charlie, he grabbed that rock with one hand. Oh, he's so funny. And then the other day he went to the Bronx Zoo. You know, next month I'll be in New York ministering for a few days. Next month, I'll be in New York ministering. What does Patrick say? We love you and Charlie the Rock. Yep. Charlie the Rock. Yep. He is. So I was going to say, I was going to say that Charlie went to the Bronx Zoo, but whenever I have New York on my mind and I think about a zoo, I was thinking about the Bronx Zoo, but I got to reframe my thought here and speak about the Brookfield Zoo.
Right.
So Charlie goes to the Brookfield Zoo. The rock collector. So Charlie goes to the Brookfield Zoo the other day with his cousin Ollie, which is on Pastor Joni's side, on the DiStefano side, or something like this. Hey, Ray, big Ray.
Ray
and Judy. Hey, Ray. Hey, in Florida, I know it's hot. It's hot here too, buddy. It's hot here too. We love Charlie. Yep. Anyway, so yeah, I was going to say the Bronx Zoo, but the Brookfield Zoo. So the two cousins, Ollie, who's a DiStefano.
turn your volume down.
I know, sorry.
Lord, I know it's not.
Thank you, Lord.
So Charlie and his cousin Ali were at the Brookfield Zoo. See, I got distracted with Brookfield Zoo versus the Bronx Zoo. And the two of them were sitting together. I have this on video. I'd love to show you. Hey, Ray, what does Ray say? Little Charlie will be hitting cleanup for the Yankees in no time. Ah, there you go, Ray. Hey, Ray, what if the White Sox sign him? Imagine that. I would have to become a White Sox fan. Imagine me, a 65-year Yankee fan, right? Anything for my grandson. Little Charlie will be hitting cleanup for the Yankees in no time. Oh, I love it. Anyway, so little Ollie, who's on the DiStefano side, on Pesagioni's side, and little Charlie were in their strollers. Thank you, Joe. Yeah. They were in their strollers together, and Charlie grabs little Ollie's water, his bottled water, away from the other side. He had he just stretched his left arm out. He could have just easily done it with his other hand, but he stretched his left arm out. He could have easily done it with his right hand. And he stretched it all the way across, and he grabbed little Ollie's water and started drinking it all with one hand. It was a big bottle. He started drinking it with one hand. He picks up rocks. He's a strong little guy. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Well, we love you all so much. If I mentioned your name, it means I love you. If I mentioned your name, it means I love you. And if I did not mention your name, it means I love you just the same.
Amen.
All right.
Amen.
All right. Amen. And I'm happy to have Maureen in the house tonight. She's helping us out with our computers and our website and everything. Yes. Yes. Somebody give it up for Maureen. Yes. Come on. Yay. And Ida's here tonight because, you know, she always wants to be where Joe is. You know, she's so in love. That Puerto Rican woman is so in love with her Italian husband.
Absolutely.
Right, Ida?
Absolutely.
She's so in love. She's so in love.
35 years.
Medea, for 35 years, she's been so in love with her Italian stallion.
Yes.
She's been so in love with her Italian stallion. And, somebody once told me, Pastor Manny will tell you too, Bishop Mark Sharona, dear friend of mine, Bishop Mark Sharona, we text each other and we have a great relationship. He said to me years ago, Marisol, thank you, Marisol Garcia, David Greer, yay, David, hey, there's David. So we trust you're doing well, David, and we thank the Lord for your complete healing.
Yes.
In the mighty name of Jesus, amen. 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 So what was I saying? Oh, so Bishop Sharona. Thank you. Bishop Sharona said to Pastor Manny and myself, he said, every Puerto Rican needs an Italian.
That's it.
And every Italian needs a Puerto Rican.
That's it.
Right, Marty? Marty, you're Puerto Rican and you need me. And I'm Italian and I need you. But you know what? Okay, what's Ray saying now? Amen to David's healing 100%.
Yes.
All right. Joe and Ida, the lovebirds. Oh, Marisol Torres calls you the lovebirds. Yeah. Now, Ida and Joe, you guys never have, in 35 years, you've never had an argument, right?
Oh, no, just one.
Just one, right?
Uh-huh.
And it's still going on?
Yeah, it's still going on.
Just one and still going on. You guys are too much. I tell people, Pastor Joni and I have, in 36 years, we've only had one argument, and it's still going on.
That's right.
No, it's all good. Pastor Gina, I will see you next month in New York. I will see you next month in New York.
Where?
New York. Well, not New York. I can't say New York City. It'll be where? Long Island.
Right.
In Long Island. I'll see you in Long Island, okay? Oh, Candy says, I love Puerto Ricans. I'm Italian. Candy, you're Italian?
No.
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 Let me tell you, she's not just Italian. You know, some people say Italian. She's a real Italian. Candy's a real Italiano. She's through and through Italian. Where? New York, Long Island. Pastor Gina, I look forward to seeing you. I'm going to be ministering in Queens. That's New York. New York City. It's part of the five boroughs, you know, Brooklyn, Bronx, Queens, Manhattan, Staten Island. Okay. But I'll be ministering at, New York. I'll be ministering in Long Island at Pastor Bill's church and Pastor Gina's church. Now, if the rapture takes place, then Joe has committed himself to being here.
I'm out.
He says he's out. Wait a minute.
I'm out of here.
Guys, listen. We may not be able to hear you where you are, but we can read your comments. But you cannot maybe hear what they're saying. Ida said if Joe's rapture, she's going to be holding on to his what? She's going to be holding on to his legs. Why? Why do you have to hold on to his legs?
Don't leave me.
Don't you think that you'll make it to heaven without him?
He'll be holding my leg.
Oh. Maybe I'll just hold.
We're both going.
You'll be holding on to each other. Hold on. Medea's talking about cannolis here. A good cannoli will go good with some chocolate milk. And I'm still waiting for my Italian. All right. Hey, there you go. All right. Hey, that's right, Pastor Gina. Your husband is Italian. Yeah. But you're not Italian, though, right? I don't think you're Italian, right? Yeah, you're right. Pastor Bill is Puerto Rican. Yep. Uh-huh. We thank the Lord. Yeah, we're excited to be with you as well. No, Joe was going on the first load. All right, yeah.
Yes, amen.
I heard that, Joe.
Yes.
All right, so listen, guys, if I mention your name, it's because I love you. And if I did not mention your name, it's because I love you. I love you all. All right. Thank you, Lamb of God. Thank you, Father God. God, really, church, thank you for honoring me for Father's Day, for my birthday. Thank you so much. You guys are so generous. Thank you all so much for your words, your encouragement, your cards. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Love you, Apostle.
What was that, Joey?
We love you.
Ah, thank you. I know you do, and I love you so much. Yes. Love you all so much. Ida says, you deserve it, Poppy. Mm-hmm. We love you, Apostle. You guys are too sweet. We love you back, Apostle Jim. Best joy. Oh, you guys, you're going to make me cry. I do cry easily, but seriously, guys, if you keep saying this kind of stuff, we love you and we love to honor you. You guys do make me cry. I was messing with you a minute ago, but I do feel like crying, though. I really do. Oh, my mom was Italian. Okay, well, listen, you're Italian then. Okay? You're Italian, Pastor Gina. Her mom was Italian, you know.
There you go.
Babe, your mother was Italian.
Yeah.
Right? Your mother was Italian.
My mom was Sicilian.
Your mom was Sicilian.
My father was Sicilian.
They were both Sicilian. Candy.
Sicilian through
and through. Candy. Sicilian through and through. Sicilian. And my family is almost Sicilian. I mean, we're near Calabria, you know, Basilicata. Excuse me? Maureen, would you just lean over toward Pastor Joni? And I said to behave herself. Would you do that? Hey, Maureen and Pastor Joni, they went to the Philippines together.
We did. We were just talking about
that. You were talking about the Philippines?
Yeah.
Yeah, we love. I've been to the Philippines.
Yes, you have.
You've been there, Ida? You went to the Philippines?
I was there in 1979.
Yes. Let me tell you, and the Filipino people, their culture, they're so sweet. They're so sweet. Yes, they are. But all of Encounter Church, you guys are all so sweet. Yes, you are. And thank you again for blessing me so much. Thank you. All right. Where do we begin to speak the word of the Lord for tonight? Really, Joe, you were anointed tonight. And we engaged and we received together in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus. Thank you, Father God. Did warfare tonight. Say it, Joe. Come on, say it.
We accomplished what God wanted us to do tonight.
We accomplished what God wanted us to do tonight.
Together.
Yes, we did. Joe, if you would stay right here, if you would, buddy, if you would. And let's read, because there's nothing like the word of the Lord. Listen to me. There's no substitute for this word. There's many different kind of weird doctrines out there. But there's no substitute for the authentic, the undeniable word of the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
Okay. Okay, in 2 Corinthians 12, 2 Corinthians 12, let me just look it up myself. In 2 Corinthians 12, guys, if you have your Bibles or just want to listen, because I know you read your Bibles, 2 Corinthians 12, okay? All right. Okay, actually, 2 Corinthians 12, we're going to start with verse 7, Joey. We're going to start in verse 7. And we're going to go all the way down to verse number 10. Okay, now, 2 Corinthians 12, starting with what, Joe?
Verse 7.
Verse 7. Now, before Joe reads, we want to be careful of even here not to bring any judgment, even though it took place 2,000 years ago, we don't want to bring any judgment to what the Apostle Paul was going through at that time. Fast forwarding 2,000 years later, here we are on June 29th, 2022, 7:41 Central Standard Time. When Joe reads what he does, we don't want to bring any judgment on any of us. So what Joe's about to read, don't let the enemy put thoughts in your mind to bring judgment toward me, as the same for the people in Corinth, not bringing judgment upon the Apostle Paul, or else it backfires. Okay, so I'll tell you what I mean as Joe reads. So here we have the Apostle Paul. He's crying out to God. Listen to me, folks. He is in extreme pain. Somebody comment, extreme pain. He is in extreme pain. Now, the pain he was in, I'm going to share with you something the Lord put on my heart about his pain. But as he reads 2 Corinthians 12, let's start with verse number 7, and you'll see why I prefaced what I did. Okay, go ahead, Joey.
And lest I should be exalted above measure by the abundance of the revelations.
Say that one more time.
And lest I should be exalted above measure by the abundance of the revelations.
Okay, so you see that God has given Paul abundance of revelations. Abundance of revelations. God gave the Apostle Paul, and he said, lest I should be exalted above measure by the abundance of revelations. Go on, Joe.
A thorn in the flesh was given to me.
A thorn in the flesh was given to me. Was given to me. Now, this thorn in the flesh, some will tell you that it was a physical pain. And I'm not going to debate that. Honestly, I'm not. There are things in what we call apologetics. Apologetics was a class in Bible college. That's the equivalent of being an attorney and having a debate. That's apologetics, okay? So I'm not going to get apologetically theological on you by saying that it was not a fleshly situation that he was going through, because frankly, I am not 100% certain, and I don't know of any Bible scholar. I'm not a scholar, but I don't know of any Bible scholar that knows for sure what it was. Now, read again from the beginning, Joe.
And lest I should be exalted above measure by the abundance of the revelations.
So he's dealing with a lot of revelations he's receiving. So now listen to this part.
A thorn in the flesh was given to me.
So a thorn in his flesh. So in other words, he felt something physical attack his body. Paul the great apostle felt something in his body. But was it something physical? Not necessarily. It could have been a betrayal. I believe, as many Bibles teach, that the thorn in his side was the cares of the churches. I believe Paul's thorn in the side was his love. out of the abundance of revelation he had as a minister, as a teacher. Paul was one of the greatest teachers alive. Before he served God, he was a great teacher. Just that he was teaching against God. But he had great insight of negativity. But when he had his revelation and he was thrown from his horse and he was blinded by the light, he had godly revelation. And Paul had so much revelation that he was attacked with a thorn in his side. Now, I believe this attack affected his physical body because I believe it was an attack that really entered his soul, affected his spirit. And when something affects your spirit, it what? It affects your body.
Yes.
Solomon said in Proverbs, a broken spirit dries the bones, but a merry heart does good like a medicine. So a broken spirit hurts your bones.
Yes.
A broken heart can lead to arthritis. A broken heart can cause nerve damage. Hear me. A broken heart can cause nerve damage. A broken heart can affect you physically, where you go without sleep. I believe the greatest thorn in Paul's side was not necessarily a physical attack, but a spiritual attack that affected him physically. You see, folks, when I get attacked, it affects my spirit, my soul, that is my mind, my will, my intellect, my emotions, and it affects my body. It's what happens when you get attacked. When your spirit is broken, when you go through a situation, a divorce, a covenant breaking,
right,
it affects your spirit.
Right.
And then it affects your soul. And then it affects your body. So I believe that Paul's thorn in the side, yes, I'll agree with all of the above on that one. Yes, I believe it was an attack against his body. But the root, I believe in, it was an attack against his spirit, his mind,
right,
his mind. Now, earlier I said, now don't judge Paul. I said, don't judge him.
Right.
And I said, let's fast forward to 2,000 years later. Don't judge me. Don't judge each other. Don't judge your loved ones.
Right.
Don't judge
right.
your church. Don't judge your family. You say, why do you say that? Again, Joe, read verse 7.
And lest I should be exalted above measure by the abundance of the revelations.
One more time, Joe.
And lest I should be exalted above measure by the abundance of the revelations.
Ah, so some would say the revelation of the Lord got to Paul's head. See what I'm saying?
Right.
That would be judgmental.
Could
it be that the revelation he received from the Lord was so heavy that the devil tried to attack him from preaching the good news?
Right, right.
From preaching the good news. So some will tell you that Paul got infested with pride. Well, the worst case scenario is if he did, I'm sure he made it right with God.
That's right.
But I don't believe Paul was infested with pride. Hear me? I believe he was infested with revelation. And people were coming against him because they got jealous of the revelation.
Right.
The Pharisees, they had all the information. Paul, Saul of Tarsus, Saul before he became Paul. Later he became Paul, from Saul to Paul. He received revelation. Again, Joe, starting in verse 7.
And lest I should be exalted above measure.
Unless I should be exalted above measure. So what was he doing? He was examining himself.
That's right. Yes, he was.
He was examining his heart like we're supposed to do when we receive Holy Communion.
Right.
Let a man examine himself. Let a woman examine herself. So I say, how arrogant could Paul have been if he was humbling himself to say, God, if there's anything in me? I believe that the Lord allowed this thorn in the side to keep Paul focused, focused enough to say, I'm allowing this to show you an even greater revelation.
Yes.
We'll get into that.
Yes.
You said, what are you labeling tonight's message? I don't know. I don't know.
Because, that's a good title.
Huh?
That's a good title.
I don't know. How about all day, every day? I don't know. Why? Because I'm just up here, I open up my Bible, and the Lord is speaking.
Amen.
Now, if you want to hear a message, I can give you a message. Satan, the Lord rebuke you. If you want to hear a message, I can give you a message. Faith for today will make everything okay. You want to hear a message? The remnant. And that's what we'll do that on Sunday, perhaps. But right now, and I'll be led of the Lord, whatever it is I speak. But right now, Amen. I'm just speaking what God's putting in my spirit right now.
Amen.
Folks, this is fresh out of the oven.
Yes.
Urban. Italiano, urban. How do you say bread in Spanish? How do you say bread in Spanish? Hey!
Pan.
Hey, she's on her phone. How do you say bread in Spanish?
Pan.
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 Pan. How do you say bread in Filipino?
Inapay.
Inapay. Pinapay. Okay. Uban.
Close.
I'm right now by the leading of the Holy Spirit. Listen to this. Now, here's an example. I'm right now leading. Ooh, Maris, I had to put a loaf of bread there. Now you're making me so hungry. But right now, I'm speaking. Listen to me. I'm speaking by the revelation of the Holy Spirit. Confirmed when Pastor Benny laid his hands and prophesied on me.
Yes.
Confirmed when Pastor Rod Parsley laid hands on me and said the same thing. I'm speaking right now out of an abundance of revelation. Now, am I being arrogant in saying that?
No.
No. No.
Am I being confident?
Yes.
I'm being confident in the anointing of the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
I'm being confident in the grace of God upon me.
Right.
Well, many misjudged Paul, saying, because they were jealous of him. They were jealous of him. So why did then Paul say, you know, the abundance of revelation? Why? Because he was such a humble man that he said, Lord, if there's anything in me. You see, in Paul's day, people spoke out their sins. And the Bible says even today, James, the half-brother of Jesus, says, confess your sins one to another. My God. You have Christians confessing gossip.
Come on.
The Bible says, can I ask you a question? And I'm not blaming this on anybody. When will the real church be the real church
right. In
its entirety?
Yes.
I mean, the Bible says, confess your faults one with another.
Yeah.
When was the last time you went out to Panera with somebody and confessed your sin to them? I was going through Facebook about a week or so ago, just looking, and this man, why? He was engaged to this woman, and she was killed in a car crash. He's one of my Facebook friends. And he was taking on the guilt that if he was there, and if he would have been there in time, that perhaps he could have saved her life because he would have wound up taking her to where she wanted to go. And he was dealing with this guilt. And he went on Facebook. And he repented to everybody on Facebook. And he said, man, if I would have been there, I was 60 miles away, he said. I was 60 miles away. And if I would have been there, chances are she would have been alive today. Well, first of all, you know who's at work there, right?
Yeah.
Who's at work?
The enemy.
The enemy. Bringing what?
Condemnation.
Condemnation. But the point is this. This man made this Facebook post. And I was so, I don't even know him. I have 5,000 friends and I think I know 150 of them. And that's you and a couple other friends. I got 5,000 friends, maybe close to 200 I know. But he's a Facebook friend of mine. And what really blessed me was as this man's pouring out his heart. I mean, he's confessing
He didn't confess sin because he didn't sin. But if he confessed this, how much all the more should we confess our guilt?
Right.
And I love the responses by the body of Christ. He had like 1,200, at least when I got to see it, he had 1,200, not just likes or loves or cares, you know, or sad faces, people responding, saying, brother, we love you.
Yes.
Brother, we care for you.
Yes.
That's the church. That's the church. That's the church. And this is a man confessing something that he was not guilty of. I'll say it again. This was a man confessing something he was not guilty of. How much all the more should the church,
yes,
should we confess our faults,
yes,
one to another?
Yes.
So that's why Paul spoke out. He wasn't some arrogant Jew. He was before he got saved. But when he got blinded by the light, thrown off his horse, he became such a humble man. But God was still trying to teach Paul a greater revelation. And let me tell you something. Revelation comes with a price.
Sure does.
Revelation comes with a price. The anointing will cost you everything. If there's anything I ever learned from people like Catherine Kuhlman, Benny Hinn, the anointing will cost you everything. And when they said that, they were not being martyrs. But just like an olive, for it to produce oil, it has to be crushed. If you want to walk in the anointing, you have to learn how to be crushed. And the process is not always fun. The process is not always fun. But when you see the progression and the promise and you see the purpose, then you see the prize. Don't ask me to repeat what I just said. I know I said it, but I said it by the Spirit. Okay, now you have a greater revelation, so we're going to go a little faster, starting with verse 7 all over again, Joey.
And lest I should be exalted above measure by the abundance of the revelations.
See, the revelations God gave him, Paul examined his own heart. He wasn't big-headed. What I said before about you don't want anyone to bring judgment, people misquote scripture all the time. They say, well, you know, the reason why God's punishing him is because he's so proud. She's so arrogant. Listen, judge not, lest you be judged, right? Paul was not being arrogant. On the contrary, he was being humble.
Right.
And he was confessing things like this man on Facebook who says, if I was there 60 miles away and perhaps my fiance would have lived. Okay, one more time, John.
And lest I should be exalted above measure by the abundance of the revelations.
Abundance of revelations, folks. I thank God for abundance of revelations, but it comes at a price, with a price. Go ahead, Joy.
A thorn in the flesh was given to me.
A thorn in the flesh was given. All right? Think about the word given when somebody gives you something. Right? If somebody gives you something, you can accept it or
reject it.
Hear me, folks. Be careful who you reject. And be careful what you reject. You say, but it feels so painful. It feels so harsh. Be careful what you accept and be careful what you reject. Paul accepted this incredible pain. He accepted it. Now, I know some would say that's not a good confession. Well, if you stay in the context, scripturally, textually, theologically, of the Word of God, then you'll understand that Paul was not only a humble man, but a teachable man. Read on, Jojo.
A messenger of Satan.
What?
To buffet me.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. No, it had to be a messenger of the Lord.
A messenger of Satan.
A messenger of Satan. A demon. God's angels are not messengers of Satan.
Right.
Holy angels, Michael and Joy.
A messenger of Satan to buffet me.
To buffet me. Some Christians interpret the word buffet for buffet. Buffet, eat, mangiare, okay?
A messenger, say it again, Joe.
A messenger of Satan to buffet me.
To buffet me. It was given to me, which means God allowed it. God allowed it. Remember, Satan could do nothing to Job without God's permission.
That's right. That's right.
Satan can do nothing. Satan could do nothing against Job without God's permission. And Satan could do nothing against the Apostle Paul. Not Saul of Tarsus. The Apostle Paul without God's permission. Read that part again, Jojo.
A messenger of Satan to buffet me.
To buffet me. To hurt me. To hurt me. Now, I know some of you may be thinking, does God hurt us? Does God strike us? Hold on to your seat. Your daddy is a good daddy.
Yes, he is.
Amen. Your daddy is a good daddy.
Yes.
Somebody comment, my daddy is a good daddy, and put a capital D next to daddy if you could. If you could. Your daddy is a good daddy. But you remember the show years ago? Some of you are probably too young. Father Knows Best.
Yes.
There are things that he allows. Not things that he causes, but things that he allows. Now, on occasion, there are things that God causes. There are things that God causes that are meant not to harm you, but sometimes to wake us up, to shake us up, to get us where we need to be. Read again, Joe, slowly.
A messenger of Satan to buffet me.
Mm-hmm. To cause me to lose some sleep. Cause me to depend on God. Remember that Satan is just God's puppet on strings.
Right.
Satan is God's puppet on strings. Remember that, okay? And your God is a rewarder, okay? Your God loves you. Your God is not out to harm you, okay? Let me make that very clear. Your God is not out to harm you. There you go. Go ahead, Joe.
Lest I be exalted above measure.
So he examined himself. Lord, I'm not going to exalt myself with the revelation you've given me. See, so many people misinterpret that. He examined his heart. So when Paul said that, God allowed a test to take place. And he said, Satan, I'll allow you to do this, but just remember that he's my property and that no weapon formed against him is going to prosper. See, there's one thing to have a weapon formed against you. It's another thing for you allowing it to prosper.
Right, right.
I hear Christians say Isaiah 54:17, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. I hear people say that a lot. Then they say, but how come it's prospering? Well, just because the word says something, it doesn't mean it's always going to happen unless you activate it. No weapon formed against you will prosper when you allow God to do the work that he desires in you. Go ahead, Joe. Keep reading.
Concerning this thing, I pleaded.
Concerning this pain, this agony I was going through. Why do I believe this pain was the cares of the churches? Because he had such incredible revelation. Incredible revelation. That God allowed the enemy to test him, to prove that he has great revelation, but he's about to receive even greater revelation. Go ahead, Joe.
Concerning this thing, I pleaded with the Lord.
Oh, stop, Joe. I pleaded. You know the word plead means to beg? I begged the Lord. I begged. That's how desperate he was. Because the word says, I've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor their seed begging for bread. But Paul was in so much anguish. He had such great revelation, and the people weren't getting it. He had such great revelation and the people weren't getting it. So you know what he said? Lord, am I the problem?
Is Jimmy the problem? Is Paul the apostle? Is Joseph preparing the problem? So the Lord allows Satan, puppet on strings, to put him through a test to show Satan not only that Paul has revelation, but he's about to get a greater revelation. Yes. And tonight, church, you're about to get a greater revelation.
Hallelujah.
Go on, JoJo.
Concerning this thing, I pleaded with the Lord 3 times that it might depart from me.
Now I hear people say, well, just speak the word just 1 time. And you'll have whatever you say. And I believe in confessing the word. I believe in it. But Paul, not once, twice, 3 times. Now, I know some will say, well, he was filled with fear, doubt, and unbelief. He just should have said it 1 time. Saying this about the Apostle Paul. I tell you, folks, we gotta think before we speak.
Right.
And judge our hearts. We got to judge our hearts before the Lord.
We do.
Oh, yes, we do. Okay, JoJo.
Concerning this thing, I pleaded with the Lord 3 times that it might depart from me. And he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you.
3 times. And what did the Lord say? Say it, JoJo.
My grace is sufficient for you.
3 times. He cries out to the Lord, and the Lord says, he didn't say, rise and be healed in the name of Jesus. Nope. Nope. What did he say, Joe?
My grace is sufficient for you.
As much revelation that the Apostle Paul had, the Lord said, I'm going to give you now, Paul, greater revelation. Because as the head goes, the body follows. Which means, church, you're about to get greater revelation, is what Paul's saying. So listen to this, folks. You can laugh at this one. This is how stupid the devil is. So God uses Satan so that Paul is tested through the puppet on strings, but God was behind everything as the director so that God can show Satan that Paul is a humble man. And not only is a humble man, but Satan, I'm going to use you. Satan, I'm going to use you. This is God saying this to Satan, I'm going to use you to allow Paul to receive greater revelation.
Yes. Yes.
Did you catch that?
Yes.
Did you catch that?
Yes, I did.
Be careful who you're rebuking, folks. Now, yes, Satan, the Lord, rebuke you. But what I'm saying is God allowed the devil, where the devil meant to hurt Paul physically, spiritually, mentally, psychologically, emotionally. The Lord says to the devil, see, you got to see the whole concept here. Devil, go ahead. Just remember, he's mine, and that no weapon. See, this thorn in the flesh was a weapon.
Right.
It was a weapon. And it was formed against Paul, was it not?
Yes. Yes.
But it did not prosper.
Yes. Hallelujah.
It did not prosper. In fact, it backfired.
Right.
Read that again, Joe, about the grace.
My grace is sufficient for you.
3 times he cries out to God to take away the pain. What does the Lord say?
My grace is sufficient for you.
What a revelation Paul received thanks to the thorn in the flesh. Thanks to the thorn in the flesh for the people that hurt Paul, for the people that deserted Paul. What did Paul do? He checked his own heart,
right,
his own motives, so that he would be pure in the eyes of God and stay focused on his assignment. So God says, devil, watch this. God's a show off.
Yeah.
You know, when he created you, you know, the day you were born, he showed you off.
Yes. He did. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. So he cries out 3 times. And what does the Lord do?
My grace is sufficient for you.
My grace is more than enough for you.
Thank you, Lord.
more than enough for you. More than enough for you. So now Paul's getting this greater revelation. Greater revelation. We're on the grace of God. Read that again. Oh, no, go on now, Joe. Go on.
For my strength is made perfect in weakness.
Oh, you know what I'm going to do, guys? I'm just going to close this book here. And we're just going in my notes here, which I thought I had and everything else. Excuse me for a second, Joe. I'm putting it down. Say that again, JoJo.
For my strength is made perfect in weakness.
God says, my strength is made perfect in weakness. If you feel like you're going through a weak moment, if you feel like you're in a season of weakness, if you feel like the devil's been all over you, beating your guts out, your brains out, think twice. First of all, you're a child of God.
Yes. Right.
Second of all, no weapon formed against you shall prosper.
Right.
Now, when you stay out of judgmentalism, you're safe. When you stay out of being critical, you're safe. When you stay out of gossip, you're safe. But no weapon formed against God's righteous saints who fear him will prosper. Read that part again, JoJo.
For my strength is made perfect in weakness.
So here, Paul, in his weakest moment, received his greatest strength.
Yes.
Did you hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
Paul was never weaker in the natural, but at that moment became the strongest man on earth spiritually. Read that again, Joe.
For my strength is made perfect in weakness.
Perfecto, lacking nothing. If you're at a place where in the natural or even spiritually you feel your weakest, you're about to get your greatest promotion.
Amen.
Right now, I'm in a season of weakness. I've already been prophesied I'm going to pass the test.
Yes.
Amen.
By the grace of God, I will. I'll let the teacher grade the test, not the student.
Right.
I'll let the teacher grade the test, right, not the student.
Amen.
We have a lot of students grading tests. And don't get confused. There's a difference between a test and a quiz.
Yeah, right.
In school, I used to do great on quizzes and terrible on tests. But this is a test. The body of Christ in America is being tested. You are being tested. I am being tested. I got to close. So read that again, Joe.
For my strength is made perfect in weakness.
So what is God doing right now? He's perfecting the saints.
Yes.
Ephesians 6. God's perfecting the saints. God is perfecting the saints. That's my call. My call is perfecting
Amen.
The saints.
Amen.
That's my call. Perfecting the saints. I said Ephesians 6, that's the armor of God. But Ephesians 4, he's given us the fivefold ministry. Ephesians 4:11, and he gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors, some teachers, for the equipping of the saints. I'm glad I put my notes away. Just good to be led by the Holy Ghost. For the equipping of the saints. My job is to equip you. God is equipping me. But the way that he's equipping me is he's allowing me to go through a greater season of totally depending on him. It doesn't mean I'm overwhelmed with such an abundance of revelation that the revelation is getting to my head. That's what people said about Paul, and they were wrong. People say that today about some preachers, and they're wrong. Now, I'm sure some are arrogant. I'm sure some have self motives that are outside the will of God to please themselves. That's between them and God. Let God be their judge. But we're in the body of Christ going through a season where God wants to perfect the saints. Where when you say, Satan, the Lord rebuke you, you can say it with such confidence and assurance and authority, power and boldness, because you know that it was not you that said it. In fact, you were too weak to say it.
Right.
But the Holy One in you said, Satan, the Lord rebuke you. You say, Pastor Jim, what are you talking about? I'm talking about allowing God to strip you to where truly he is the potter and we are the clay. Yeah. Where he can mold us around the potter's wheel. Where we're spinning. You ever go on a ride? You ever go on a ride and it spins so much and you get off that ride and you're like, you know, you get off that ride and you're like spinning. Patrick Bulbank said on Sunday, he said, Apostle, you're like in Ezekiel 47. Remember the ankles, the waist, the knees, too deep. Patrick Bulbank said, Apostle, you're in such depth of God's revelation that it's out of control, where you're totally depending on him because he's a jealous God. Folks, you're in a good place. I said, you're
yes.
in a good place.
Yes.
It's ugly out there, but you're in a good place.
Yes.
I said, it's ugly out there, but you're in a good place. You cave dwellers, hear what I'm saying. Like we said on Sunday about the cave of Abdullah. All right? You're in a cave right now. We're in a cave. There's nothing glamorous about a cave. There's bats. It's cold. It's humid. It's uncomfortable. Forget about chairs. You're surrounded around rocks. But the cave dweller, like David's 400 men that ran to that cave, you're in a place now where the Lord says, I want you to be drained of you, Jimmy.
Yes. Yes.
Drain me.
Yes.
Oh, I remember what Catherine Kuhlman said in 1968 at the Americana Hotel that I was there in the central part of Manhattan. The way she spoke, that little frail woman with her psychedelic clothing and colors, she said, God's not looking for a perfect vessel, but a yielded vessel. But a yielded vessel. Folks, it's easy to say that I'm yielded. It's easy to sing, breathe upon me, breath of God, yielded to your spirit. It's easy to sing that. But like Paul, God brought him to a place where when Paul would speak out against the enemy, he knew it was God in him. Christ in you, the hope of glory.
Amen.
And you have all the strength in the world through Christ.
Yes.
Yes.
I can do all things through Christ.
Yes.
But apart from Christ, I'm nothing.
Yes.
I have nothing and I can do nothing. When I go through my muddy waters and my deepest trials, he's my rock. My shield, my fortress, my deliverer, in him will I trust. I will trust in the Lord with all my heart and lean not to my own understanding. And in all my ways, I will acknowledge him and he will direct my path.
Amen.
Read that again, John, we'll close.
For my strength is made perfect in weakness.
I mean, it's right there. So God allowed the enemy, listen to this, folks, get rid of this shout at home and in this house. God allowed Satan for Paul to go to a new place of revelation of the grace of God. Come on!
Yes! Hallelujah! Hallelujah!
Finish it off, Joey. Bring it home, Joey. Bring it home, Joey. It's a ninth inning. Bring it home, Joey.
Therefore, most gladly, I will rather boast in my infirmities.
Hold on! He goes from begging three times, God, take it away. Now he's saying, Lord, I'm getting stronger in you.
Yes.
Because I'm going so deep in you that it's out of control where I'm forced to depend on you. I'm forced to depend on you. Read that again, Joe.
Therefore, most gladly.
Most gladly. I will.
Rather boast.
I'd rather boast. He's not boasting about his big head. Or his inflated ego? He's boasting about what?
My infirmities.
He's thanking God for the infirmities. In other words, what he's saying is, Lord, In the natural, I would never want this. But now, thank you, Lord. You have to understand, folks, he wasn't saying thank you, Lord, for the pain. Thank you, Lord, for sickness. No, we don't thank him for it. We thank him through it and in it. Paul was thanking God in it. In it, because in it, he learned how to the level of the grace of God. Read it again, Joey.
Therefore, most gladly, I will rather boast in my infirmity.
In other words, I'm going to rejoice because I'm being made stronger in Christ. You know, what did John the Baptist say? His ministry didn't last long. He said, I must what?
Decrease.
And he must increase. That's where the church is going to go through now. A place of decrease.
Yes.
Encounter. Hear me. Read my big fat Italian lips. We're going to go through a season of decrease.
Yes.
To bring increase.
Yes. Amen.
Read my big fat Italian lips.
Hallelujah.
We're going to go through a season of decrease. To bring us to a place of increase. Read that again, Joey boy.
Therefore, most gladly.
Gladly. You say, why are you acting this way? I'm glad. Beats being sad, mad. I'm glad. You say, but you're being beat up. You've been, oh, wow. Satan is the puppet on strings here.
Yes, he is.
And God is using him. Go ahead. God's using him.
I will rather boast in my infirmities.
Go ahead.
That the power of Christ may rest upon me.
So that the power of Christ may rest upon you. So here's what's happened to Jimmy Boy at 65 on Medicare. What you're seeing before your eyes. What you're seeing before your eyes is the power of Christ resting upon me. And the day that I turned 65, in my office at my home, at about, 11 o'clock in the morning, babe,
yep.
I wept and wept and wept. I had the most freshest of encounters with the Lord.
Yes.
He took me back 65 years. And can I tell you who he used to do it?
Yes.
He used your daughter, Andrea. Andrea wrote me a card.
Yes.
She wrote me a card.
So sweet.
And she said, Apostle, I can only imagine the journey that you've been on for 65 years.
Wow.
I put the card down and I sat in my chair. And on my 60, I told you on my 65th birthday, I told you weeks ago. When some were here and some were not here, I told you weeks ago, when I turned 65, something was going to happen.
Yes.
And I told you, if the Lord tarries my 50th year in ministry, which is only 2 years from now, 2 years is my jubilee in ministry, something even crazier is going to happen.
Yes.
Yes.
On my 65th birthday at about 11 a.m., the Lord brought my whole life to me. He brought 65 years to my remembrance all within a matter of minutes. A little boy in a hospital. A little boy urinating blood. He brought me through every aspect of my life. The rejection of divorce. The rejection of losing a child. He brought me through every aspect of my life. Hear me. He brought me through every aspect of my life. When I was 1 foot tall, 2 foot tall, 3 foot tall. When I was 14, 18, 29, 36. He brought me through every aspect and I wept and I wept and I wept. When I had lots of hair, little hair. When I had no glasses, 2 glasses. When I had pretty big muscles to having small muscles. Paul's thorn, I believe, was that he loved the church so much. And he was giving them such great revelation.
And people just did not want to hear it. And Paul could have easily said about that messenger of Satan, he could have easily said, "Satan, the Lord rebuke you." But sometimes you got to know that God may be putting you in that wheel. And it doesn't always feel good, and sometimes it gets hot. But Proverbs 17:3 says, "A refining fire will have you coming out like gold." So just finishing Corinthians there. 2 Corinthians 12. I know you're getting touched tonight, church. I know you are.
Verse 10?
Yeah.
"Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches."
I take pleasure in infirmities. That's crazy. That's crazy stuff. He's not saying I want it, but he says no weapon formed against me shall prosper. You see, that weapon didn't prosper. The revelation did.
Yes. That's it.
Go back to 9 again.
"And he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you."
He's saying, Encounter Church, whatever you're going through, my grace is more than enough. Yes. Jesus said, the word says he gives you more grace, more grace, more grace. Go on, Joe, right from there.
"For my strength is made perfect in weakness."
You want to see God perfect you? We're talking about perfecting the saints. I just read Ephesians 4, God perfecting the saints. Yep. When you say, "God, unmask me, unclothe me spiritually."
Yes.
Folks, I told you before, the New Testament church will arise in the last days.
Yes.
If the Lord says the restoration of all things is going to come, he means it's going to come. And I believe the day is going to come that Christians are going to confess their sins one to another.
Amen.
It's the Bible.
Yes.
It's not our culture, but it's the Bible. Good, Joe.
"Therefore, most gladly..."
Gladly!
I would rather...
Remember the word "rather's" there. Nobody wants to boast about pain. He said, but I'd rather boast about the infirmities and receive this new fresh revelation. There's a difference there. He didn't say, "Lord, let the devil beat me up anywhere, anytime." He says, nope. He says, "Lord, I know you're using the enemy to bring me to a greater place." That's why you got to be careful who you're rebuking.
Yes.
You know, you may think that person's tormenting you. They may be trying to mentor you.
Right. Amen. Right.
Yes, 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 yes.
Finish, Joe. Yes.
"Therefore, yes, most gladly, I will rather boast in my infirmities."
I'd rather, if it's going to bring me closer to Christ and I'll get a fresher revelation of God's grace, here I am, Lord. Through you, I can do it, Lord.
"That the power of Christ..."
The power of Christ!
"...may rest upon me."
May rest upon me in spirit, soul, and body. For you.
"Therefore, I take pleasures in infirmities, in reproaches, in needs."
Who comes against me? Who says what about this? Me? If my budget comes, if I run out of money before I run out of month, he says what, Joe?
"In reproaches, in needs, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in needs, in persecutions."
Separate, in persecutions? Now you say, wait a minute, is this the real gospel? Listen to the end. Stick around for the end.
"In distresses."
Distresses?
"For Christ's sake."
For Christ's sake.
"For when I am weak, then I am strong."
Goodbye. Drop the mic. Say it again, Joe.
Yes.
"Therefore, for when I am weak..."
You're getting blessed, aren't you?
I am. "For when I am weak..."
When I'm what, church? Weak. Yes.
"Then I am strong."
Yep. Amen. So, folks, my 65th birthday going forward, I've never been stronger.
Amen.
Because His grace is greater than I could ever imagine. We receive that now. Joe, you did a great job. Didn't Joe do a great job? Pastor Eddie, did you have a good time with the youth and young adults?
Yes, we did. Yes,
well, now, seal this, baby. Seal this, baby. Seal this, baby.
"For when we are weak, then He makes us strong." Listen, the enemy wants to beat us down, but God makes us strong. And tonight, we seal the word that was spoken over us in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, we thank you that we were able to set the table for you and you had your way, Father God. And we thank you, Father God, that there's strength in you. And because the enemy tries to come and hit us with the right, hit us with the left, and try to knock us down, we seal that in the name of Jesus that we are strong. And we are stronger together. And we are stronger as one. And we seal the word right now in Jesus' mighty name. I want you to shout and comment, amen and amen and amen. Even from your couch, I want you to shout, amen. Because the Father is doing it. And because the Father is doing it tonight, we have the awesome opportunity to honor the Father. Amen. In our weakness, He makes us strong. He is the strength giver. He is the provider. He is the Alpha. He is the Omega. He is the beginning. He is the end. And tonight, we have the opportunity to honor the beginning, to honor the end with our tithe, with our offering, with our oblation, with our first fruits. And we have the opportunity to do it for tonight together as one team. So tonight, you can do it. Honor the Lord via PayPal. The bottom of the link. Click on it. Honor the Lord. Call the church. Leave a message. If no one answers, leave a message. We'll get back to you. Mail in your check or drive around the church tonight for a unique, unique, unique night that we had tonight. Honor the Lord tonight by driving around and dropping it in the black secure mailbox because we are stronger in our weakness. Amen. We are stronger in our weakness. So we have the opportunity to honor the Lord tonight in the mighty name of Jesus as one team. And we look forward. Listen to me. We look forward to being together in the house of the Lord on Sunday evening as one team. Sunday morning. I'm thinking evening today. I'm excited about what's happening.
Maybe you're
Sunday prophesying. Sunday morning. God is going to do something great. And we are excited. I am excited. See, one of the things that one of my coaches told me and one of my mentors told me was this, that when you're really excited and you really believe something, Eddie, you use your hands. So I use my hands a lot because I'm excited. And this Sunday morning, we have the opportunity to gather together. So if you are in the area, we invite you to join us on Sunday morning. We love you. We love you. Facebook Live at 10:20. At 10:20, we gather together on Facebook Live, 10:20, 10 a.m. in person as one team, all of us. Yes. 10 a.m. and 10:20
yes.
as one team.
And we're back on YouTube.
Yes, we are.
Yay!
Thank you, Maureen.
And Anne-Marie?
Anne-Marie, yep.
Anne-Marie Bolbang and Maureen?
Yep.
Right?
Anne-Marie, yep.
Mm-hmm. Anyone else?
And Emmanuel.
And Emmanuel. Mm-hmm. Thank you. We're back on YouTube.
Yep, we are.
YouTube. We love it. How do you do? Peace out? Folks, I'm telling you, somebody needs to hear this message. Share this message with somebody. I don't mean just hit a button, but tell somebody you need to hear this word. This is a word of the Lord. It all just came fresh from heaven. It's His word. Anyway, so we did our tithes and offerings?
We did.
Yeah. We gave tonight?
Yes, we did.
I love you guys so much. Peace in the name of Jesus. Most of all, we give the word of life.
Yes.
Word of life. Amen. Tremendous Thursday.
Yes. Fabulous Friday.
Sensational Saturday.
And another super Sunday.
And another super Sunday morning.
Yes, morning.
And a super Sunday, super Sunday night.
Super Sunday morning. And we enjoy together.
Love
yes.
you. Guys, you're great students. Love you so much. That was the word of the Lord. You're strong in Him.
Yes.
That's where
Amen.
We are.
Love you.
Amen.
Pastor Joni says what?
Love you.
Love you.
You're the best.
Love you. Good night. Bye-bye.